Hi, everybody. My name is Jeremy. I'm from Bullard. I'm based in Singapore. I'm very happy that I'm being invited today to give some sharing knowledge on what I've been learning since I've been Bullard and during the pandemic. I'd like to share more on what I've been seeing in Asia and also in US because of our headquarter manufacturing sits in US. Today's topic will be all on PAPR. So before we jump into PAPR, I'd just like to share some terminology so that you guys will not be confused in between the presentations. So during the presentations, APF, the assigned protection factors will be mentioned very frequently. So the assigned protection factors is actually a range of 10 to 10,000. And that is a rating that is given by NIOSH to the respiratory PPEs that actually relates to the amount of contaminants that can leak into the mask. And secondly, is fit testing. So fit testing happens when we are dealing with tight fitting masks, and fit testing is to check if the respirator sits properly onto the user face, and it has to be performed annually or as needed. And most of the time, or at all times, users who are using tight-fitting face piece or mask, they have to be shaved, especially for gentlemen, have to shave, no beards. If not, you will not ensure that be a good fitting onto your face. So what is PAPR? So PAPR is actually a short term of powered air purifying respirator, PAPR. So a PAPR is a positive pressure respirator that uses a blower to force the ambient air through a filter and deliver it to your hood or mask. So a typical system includes a blower unit, a filter, battery, hood, and a breathing tube. And in most of the settings today, in healthcare settings, HEPA filter is the filter that being used. And the HEPA filter is capable and is a high efficiency filter that captures 99.99% of particulates with a mass mean of 0.3 micron in size. So the picture on the right can see the whole system, how it looks like. Who uses PAPR? Today, of course, we know that because of the pandemic, a lot of us, we know that the healthcare personnel, the frontliners, the ERs, they're all using the PAPR. But before pandemic, actually PAPR has been around for quite a while. We have users from pharmaceuticals, clean rooms, laboratories, especially now hospital, paramedics, EMT, even dentists, medical officers, firefighters, ERs, fabricators, and manufacturers, they are all using PAPR. Before the pandemic, PAPR in the hospital are usually on the standby mode if the hospital is handling a lot of the contagious diseases. So usually those type of hospital, they will be using PAPR more often than the regular hospital. Just to share, for example, like what I'm seeing, we have a CDC in Singapore. So the CDC in Singapore are mainly responsible for all the contagious diseases. So even before the outbreak of the COVID-19, the hospital alone has actually a fleet of 300 PAPR sets ready for any outbreak. But having that kind of amount and what we are seeing today, 300 sets isn't even enough for that hospital alone. So this is how bad the situation that COVID has bring us to. COVID-19. So today, everybody knows COVID-19 is bringing us to a new normal. And because of COVID-19, the PPEs that's being used in healthcare setting has also been changed. So COVID-19 is actually part of a large family of viruses that cause illness ranging from the common cold to more severe diseases such as the MERS and SARS that hit us previously. As such, during the COVID situations of the WHO, the CDCs has been constantly providing us guidelines. The WHO has actually recommended everyone to wash their hands regularly, cover their nose and mouth when sneezing, coughing, and even now talking to one another. and avoid close contact with anyone who is coughing, sneezing, or showing any sign of respiratory illness. And to think that if everybody have to follow this, the personnel that's more vulnerable are the old people, and actually also the healthcare workers and the emergency responders are those at most risk of contracting COVID-19. And since we are a US company, our product are all from the US, we are following very closely to CDC US recommendations. So currently the CDC actually recommend a cautious approach to personnel under investigations, or in short, the PUI for COVID-19. Healthcare personnel evaluating PUI or providing care for patients with confirmed COVID-19 should use standard precautions, contact precautions, airborne precautions, and use PPE. So all these actually are very common to us already today. The standard precaution and contact precautions are actually referring to contact tracing, standard social distancing. Airborne precautions refers to the needs of wearing a mask when we go out to do our social or daily activities. And with the COVID hitting us, what does it mean to Bullard? The global demand has increased largely. A lot of demand has been put onto PAPR, and all Bullard resources have shifted our priorities. We have responded by increasing capacities up to 30 times, which you guys had seen in the year earlier. We have tried to prioritizing order to the frontliners, and we are ensuring that our existing customers still maintain their respiratory protection stocks. For example, the pharmaceuticals. So they are equally important now, especially if they are in full force to produce vaccines when the day to come. So it is critical to provide proper respiratory protection to the healthcare workers to keep them safe on the job while treating the patients. The first case that actually happened in US, it happens in one of the province, St. Joseph Health in Everett, where the biocontainment evaluations and specialty treatment team treated the first COVID patients. And it was from them that the PAPR played a critical role in the best team response by maximizing respiratory protections with up to 1,000 APF protection factors. PAPR utilized loose-fitting hood that don't require fit testing and provide full respirator head and face protection in one easy system, which means the PAPR does not only provide you the respiratory protections, at the same time, they provide you head and face protection as well. And if you see the list of PPEs that they have stated for a standard PPE procedure, donning procedures, PAPR is one of them. And on top of that, CDC actually has provided us a guideline or various strategy or optimizing of using respirator. But before that, hospitals and healthcare setting, they also have to think of the engineering controls, like by placing the patient in a private room, probably a negative pressure room, and also introducing administrative controls, which we also have been seeing regularly nowadays, today. For example, like limit the number of patients going to hospitals, or exclude healthcare personnel, HCP stands for healthcare personnel, not directly involved in patient care. Limit face-to-face healthcare personnel encounters with patients, and so forth. So there is actually different set of administrative controls being implemented around the world. And because of different country, different SOP, they vary a little bit differently between countries. CDC also provide us a guideline on PPE controls. It's very important for us to understand this part because our product fall under the PPEs. Use respirator after extended life only if supplies are limited, which is what we are facing at the beginning of the pandemic. Only wear the same N95 or PAPR hood for repeated close contact encounter with different patients before removing the respirator between encounters, if supplies are limited as well. It is a best practice to replace everything in between patients if possible. And be sure not to use the same N95 and PAPR hood by one healthcare personnel for multiple encounters with different patients. This is to make sure that when they are taking care of different patients with different illness, they don't spread the diseases. Next, before I start sharing, I wanted to share, because this is a very common question that a lot of the, we receive a lot of questions on this, should we wear, what type of respirator or respiratory mask should we wear during the pandemic? So everybody, can you guys just click whatever you think it is, and we will share the result right after everybody has answered the questions. Well, I guess we have all the right people on today's webinar. Everybody will know, should know what's the differences between the different masks available to healthcare workers. So, but interestingly is that at the beginning of the pandemic, this is the most common question being asked to us or to any of the PPEs providers. Should we wear an N95 respirator or a surgical mask? Both of which are very different. So a surgical mask or a procedural mask is a loose fitting disposable mask that creates a physical barrier between the mouth and nose. These masks are intended to be worn by the healthcare personnel during surgery and protect the environment from the wearer. They are not designed to protect the wearer from inhaling airborne bacteria or virus particles. But the N95 respirators, they are a tight fitting mask that fit tight to the face and are intended to create a seal around the nose and the mouth. They are meant to help protect the wearer from inhaling infectious droplets in the environment. N95 masks require a fit test, cannot be worn by those with facial hair, and are considered negative pressure respirators that can make it more difficult for wearers to breathe. When N95 respirators are not available for requirement for use, cannot be met, the healthcare personnel or the emergency responders should have the option to protect themselves with powered air purifying respirator, the PAPRs. So actually, one does protect the user, one does not. That when this is when this guideline has been clearly written by the CDC, a lot of the surgical masks, the demand has dropped, but the N95 and the PAPRs demand has rise sharply. So as mentioned, when N95 respirators are not available or the requirements for use cannot be met, the healthcare workers should have the option to protect themselves with PAPRs. So PAPR, or sometimes referred as a power air respirators, protect personnel from airborne contaminants. But what is different from N95? Pretty much the principle of the N95 mask and the PAPR is almost the same, but there are big differences between them. The PAPR eliminates the breathing resistance of negative pressure respirators such as N95 respirator through their blower motor. A PAPR consists of a blower that pulls through and attached filters and into loose fitting hood and cover all the user head and face and shoulders for some of the models. So under the OSHA regulations, PAPR are specified for high hazard procedures because they can offer assigned protection factors APF up to 1000, which is up to 100 times that of an N95 mask. So the N95 mask actually provides 10 APF. This improved protection is largely provided by the positive pressure in the loose fitting hood. PAPR with loose fitting hood provide additional benefits in that they do not need to be fit tested and cover the entire head and shoulder of the wearer, offering respirator, eye, and splash protection in one system. So comparing to healthcare workers that's wearing an N95, they probably have to still wear a goggle, face shield, to protect them against aerosol splashes, and usually the face shield itself is not good enough to protect the eye, so they actually have to wear a goggle or eye protections as well. But comparing to PAPR, once you don on the systems, and because of the positive air and the coverage of the hood, actually you have all covered, all protected. So this is actually, there is a weight advantage over here. Since I'm from Bullard, so I will be sharing a little bit more on the Bullard PAPR. So here is our history. We started our very first PAPR in 2001, the PA20 series. Over the years, we have been trying to improve the systems, getting it lighter, getting it into various different models where some have to be used in the intrinsically safe environments. And in 2009, we have actually introduced the EVA. EVA is what we are selling, offering today. And we have the EVA HL. The HL stands for hazardous locations. And we are working and looking forward for what we can come up with next, after, especially after the pandemic, with no different concerns, different requests, different needs. And Bullard is working on it to try to come up with something that is more useful, practical to all the frontline workers. So in our product line, PAPR, as mentioned, we have the EVA, EVA HL, and loose fitting hoods. Loose fitting hood, we have the LF, the loose fitting series, or we have the RT series, which you can see this, for this, the RT series and the CC20 series, they have the kit that can cover the shoulder. But in hospital settings, in some country, they prefer the LF series, but some, they prefer the RT series or the CC20. And the difference between the RT and the CC20 is one does come with a suspension, which means that the hood, your vision of the visor will move with your head directions. But the RT series is without the suspensions, which means it's like astronaut helmets. It will always stay still. It's like a balloon. Okay, it comes with accessories like the breathing tube, filter, cartridge, the belt. We have different belts. We have the decon accessories, the airflow testing, and the, of course, the battery and the chargers. For EVA, as at the moment, we are still having the highest airflow in the industry. We have different type of loose fitting hoods to try to cover almost every different events, occasions, or even individual's preference. The EVA itself is decontamination friendly, and we went through third-party APF testing, and they are all tested. So I've generally described what's EVA HL. So what is EVA HL? EVA HL is actually same as EVA, but it comes with Class 1 Division 2. So it is actually falls under the not normally explosive environment. So usually the Class 1D1 is the one that is normally explosive, and the Class 1D4 is normally not explosive environment. Okay, so the blower itself, EVA HL, comes in additional motor seals, additional battery fault circuitry, lockdown battery, ESD coating on electronics. All these four additional features is to make the blower to be able to attain the Class 1 Division 2 certifications. So this is the very brief technical specification of EVA. We have two speed. We have the low flow at 198 liter per minute or 7 CFM. And we have the high speed at 240 liter per minute or 8.5 CFM. Okay. And what I want to share more here is the running time on the battery itself, it varies from 4 to 16. There is a big range here because of different type of hoods requires a different energy spend to deliver the same amount of airflow. And the PAPR FC3, which is the HEPA filter, when unopened in original packaging, it can be actually stored for 10 years. And all the loose fitting hoods or face piece is 5 years in an unopened original packaging conditions. Our EVA blower, our PAPR, has the active flow technology, which means that taking the concept of a car constant speed functions, if you want your car to travel on a straight road for 80 km per hour constantly, so you can activate the cruise control and we'll start going. It's very similar to this concept. Our PAPR actually has this function as well. So if you set at high airflow, it's 240 liter per minute. It will be always at 240 liter per minute. So back to the car. What if you are going upslope? And because of the upslope, the car actually drops from 80 to 70. The car will react by revving up the RPM and deliver more power to the wheels and to add the 10 more back to the speedometer so that the car can regain back to 80 kilometers per hour. So that is what the cruise control does to the car. The very same thing to the PAPR. Once the airflow is being detected that the airflow falls below 240 liters per minute, the motor itself will also rev up the RPM so that to maintain 240 liters per minute to the user. So with such kind of technology that we have in our PAPR, when sometimes there is a twisted tube, there is an incorrect connection of the tube to hood connections, there is a blocked filter, the user is still safe because the PAPR will always detect that the airflow outputs to the user is always 240. But because of that, because the high RPM, the battery lifespan drops. This explains why just now the battery lifespan will varies from 4 to 16 hours. But on average, a normal correct situations, each battery should last 6 to 8 hours. So next, this is the our battery fuel gauge. We have the fuel gauge that is built into the battery itself. We do have the low flow alarm. When that happens, a user can actually easily check the status of the battery by pressing the buttons, and you can see on the GIF on the right. And we have our battery gauge designed and built on the outside of the battery, which means after you install the battery, you still can view the gauge itself. Because we know that some models out there, they have this gauge, but it will be hidden once you install into the blower itself. So usually each blower come with a individual docking stations and one battery itself. But due to large setting in different hospitals, some hospitals they have a fleet of PAPR. So we do have a GAN charger as an optional accessories for them to choose if they want to just get a GAN charger rather than fixing up 6 individual docking stations. Next, just like to share a little bit more on individual series of the loose fitting. So the loose fitting hood, they provide high levels of protections. We do have loose fitting hood that actually only rated at 25 APF. There are only a handful of the models that actually attain only 25, because once the hood design does not cover much of your area, it cannot attain that 1000 APF. So some models, yeah, they do provide lower APF, but even at 25 APF, they are 2.5 times higher than N95. And it does not require, it's not taxing on the user lung to actually breathe, because all air, all the clean air is being delivered to the user. And it accommodates user facial hair and eyewear. Especially in today's pandemic, all the healthcare workers, they are working tirelessly, continuously, days and night to protect, to take care of the patients. And a lot of them may not have the luxury of time to take care of their personal hygiene, the personal facial hair. They have to just to, on a activation mode, they have to get back to work. So such loose fitting hood really help them a lot, allowing them have ease of mind not to keep on worrying that their facial hair may actually cause them a risk of having the contaminants into their mask if they are wearing a tight fitting mask. So 20LF is our loose fitting hood that actually covers only up to the neck areas. Countries like in US and in Singapore, healthcare workers, they are more lean towards this type of hoods. There's no right or wrong on which hood design to use, but yes, they are more lean towards this type of hoods, being that they have been used, they are used to use this type of hood. And I think in Singapore settings, they are very, in the earliest days, they are very close to US medicals, and they think likewise. That's why this preference, this is just a so preference on what kind of hood they are using. And you can see, we are actually using Tupon Titan 2000 series to build our hoods. We are all using Tupon materials. So we are happy that today, other than us, the next session will be Tupon. And I understand that we have Tupon participants here today. And we really love their materials and trust on their materials to build our PPEs since many years back until today. The CC20, large lens, no lens fogging due to because of the positive airflow, very fast dawning. We have a suspension inbuilt inside. So this hood actually provide up to 1000 APF. They actually cover up to your shoulders. The RT series, that I always call it the astronaut helmets because it's so huge and large. But of course, also if your preference is to have a very large panoramic lens and you do not want something that is tying onto your head, sitting onto your scalp, then yes, this is the one to go. It provides also 1000 APF, 100 times more than N95. I mentioned enough, but never enough that it actually provides you more than one protection, not only the respiratory. They also provide you the eye and face splash protections as well. And these models, they have 2000 series, the DuPont Titan 2000 and 4000 series. So 4000 is a higher level, a better material from DuPont. So what you see now is Spectrum. This is our tight fitting mask. The reason why I'm showing is that actually PAPR does also comes with tight fitting mask. As I've mentioned very early in my presentations that before the pandemic, PAPR are already widely used by a lot of different industry. So the more commercial industry are actually using the Spectrum, the tight fitting mask. Reason being, they are in of their application do not really allow them to wear loose fitting masks because of the confined space, or sometimes most of the time the painters, the spray painting, the full face mask with the tail lens will be a better fit than the loose fitting. That's why we do have this solution, but in healthcare settings, because of the ease of not having the user to go through the fit testing, the tight fitting mask is not really, we do not really recommend this in all the healthcare setting. Tight fitting mask also means that usually the in between each healthcare personnel, they do not share each other mask, which means they have to equip every one of them with one mask. Whereas the loose fitting mask with proper disinfections following the individual hospital SOP in each country, they can be shared. We have the decontamination options. So today's setting, we always recommend people to wipe down with dry or damp cloth using warm water or mild detergents. Of course, during the pandemic or settings, COVID-19, we always recommend people to use a cleaning agent with at least 70% alcohol content, IPA, and it will be good enough to disinfect the respirator PPEs. So furthermore, we do also have a lot of other components like the backpacks. We do have this kind of setting because not really in the healthcare, but in some of the industry, they do not like the waist mount type of PAPR. So we do have the backpack style, so they can do actually more vigorous work without having the PAPR, the waist mounted PAPR hidden their way, or blocking their ease of moving stuff. And we have different type of breathing tube to accommodate different hoods. And we have three type of filters actually. So the FC3, as I mentioned, is the HEPA filter. FC4 and FC5 are all the chemical combinations filters. So actually, how does the HEPA filters work? The FC3 are actually a mechanic type of filter that collect particles through several different mechanisms, including impactions, interceptions, gravity, and diffusions. So as you can see, all the particles actually get kind of trapped by the filters when the blower is trying to draw in air for the user. And this is the next question that I always receive during my training sessions to the user is, can the particles fall out of a HEPA filter? So as from the recommendations and the guideline, the latest guideline from CDC is that all the filters are tested against the particle size of 0.2 to 0.3 micrometers. And the minimum acceptable efficiency of the filter must hit at least 99.97%. So particles collected on the filter are trapped in the filter matrix and are not easily released from the upstream, which means the outward side of the filter. Particles are typically only released if filter is violently agitated, such as being banged on a hard surface. No particles will be able to penetrate to the downstream side after capture, which means the inner side of the filters. So this is what was being shared, being stated on the guideline of CDC. That's why there will be no concern about the releasing of particles, even when you are changing out the filters. And then the very next question that followed by this is, how often should the filter be changed? Then again, I will share again is that we really have different practices around the world. But as per CDC recommendation is that HEPA filters should be replaced when the airflow becomes restricted. So for instance, like for the EVA, for Bullard EVA PAPR, how do we know that the airflow is being restricted? So we do have an airflow, low airflow alarm. When the airflow, there's a sensor inside our blower. So if the airflow falls below 6 CFM, so 6 CFM is being dictated by the NIOSH as the minimum airflow to provide enough protections to the user against contaminants. So if it falls below, then the alarm will go. So how does the flow alarm sounds like? It's just a continuous beep that will be sent through from the blower to the hose and into the hood itself, which only meant for the user to hear it. This is because when during or in a like a operating theater setting, there will be a multiple user using PAPR. So this kind of design is to ensure that the user knows the alarm is not for themselves, it's actually for someone else. So actually the alarm is directed to the user more directly instead of just around in the environment. So when this happens, it actually means a low flow is being delivered to the user. There can be multiple reasons. There can be because of a twisted or tube. There may be a broken tube or a broken hood. But with all that, with all reason, even not only the filter that's possible that's being blocked, all of the above reason is enough for the user to stop what they are doing and go to a safe zone and do a check on the system itself. So this is the one way that we train the user to check if the filter is due to be changed. But of course, I come across some of the hospital with different type of requirements. When we have sufficient stocks of filters, some hospital actually follows a daily change out. So they do not want to bring forward the filter for the next shift or for the next day usage. So that will happen when there is sufficient filter and hoods for them to do a change out. That is the best scenario that we can have as a best practice. But you guys know shortage of stocks has happened when during the peak period of the pandemic. So it really depends on how the hospital set their SOP, and we will provide recommendations accordingly. And how do we clean the loose fitting hood? So I mentioned most of the hospital that I provide trainings, most of them, they reuse the loose fitting hoods. But before the next person use, there must be a proper clean out of the loose fitting hood, the tube and the belt, the whole set, except the filters if they are not changing out. So it's always an inside-out kind of approach, and what kind of agent they are going to use. As earlier mentioned, we also follow strictly to the CDC recommendations. With agent that's at least with content at least of 70% alcohol, it is acceptable. So during the pandemic, Bullard ourselves in USHQ, we have tried to buy some of the cleaners or the agents into our in-house lab and do the cleaning, to make sure that the very common agents that we use do not disintegrate our materials. So the list of chemical agents on the right are those that actually we have on our own account tested it, and we have tested it and making sure that it does not actually deteriorate our PPEs prematurely. But please take note is that we have done this on Bullard sole account. We have not done it together with DuPont or with any agency in US. This is just to provide additional guidelines to user. Okay, this page is really a side-to-side comparison. So why PAPR? From the first, you can see the assigned protection factors is a 10 APF versus a up to 1,000 APF. Particulate filtration, that is a slight better performance from HEPA filters, but that slight performance means they can block really out almost all the particulates with the size as small as 0.2 to 2.3 microns. And it is a positive pressure versus a negative pressures. The unrestricted of breathing, not taxing to your lungs during physical activities, really means a lot here. It may not mean a lot to young people, the young frontliners, but you know, we have a huge range of healthcare workers in the hospital. We have the fresh grads, we have people who have been in the service for 20, 30 years, and they are still now in the white gown protecting us. So sometimes it does really matters, and it does affect individual ability to focus on what they are doing. The PAPR hood is equally lightweight and comfortable as the N95 mask. But the N95 mask has a tight fitting features, which means it will stick to your face for hours per day. You guys may have seen a lot of pictures circulating in social media showing frontline workers, the nurses, the doctors have the abrasion on their face. That is the result of wearing a tight fitting mask for very long hours. And for that, the PAPR really give them a more comfort setting where they do not have get such abrasions. And because of N95, they need to wear goggle to protect their eye. And the goggle itself are also creating abrasion for long hours of wearing. And because of that, the PAPR also can provide a much more comfort setting because it's just one hood that provides all the protections needed. Fit testing is not required. I mentioned this, I think many times throughout my webinars. The loose fitting mask, the one thing I'd like to share here is that during the pandemic, I visited quite a few hospitals, speaks to quite a few doctors and surgeons, nurses, managers. One thing that interestingly they have shared with me is that they have told me even with PAPR in place, they are still wearing an N95 mask underneath the hood. I asked them why, because I said PAPR actually have provide you enough protections and much more, 100 times more than your N95 mask. So they have mentioned that, yeah, because that is the when I spoke to them, it's kind of a beginning of the pandemic. So at the beginning of the pandemic, it's a human nature that there will be people are scared. People are afraid, of course, although their job is to save life. But yes, they still want to protect themselves as much as possible. So they still will want to have one more layer of protections on top of PAPR because of Murphy Law. So nobody can guarantee that when your blower will stop blowing, when your battery stops working. So most of them are doing that in surgeon, in operating theater, is that when they are doing operations for any COVID confirmed patients or even with a patient with contagious diseases, they will want to wear an N95 underneath the PAPR hood. So to if the blower really fail on them, they are still protected. So this is the kind of thing I heard there. And because of that, some of the hospitals do not go for a tight-fitting PAPR. So there is a PAPR out there that actually offer the tight-fitting type of like our spectrum. They does offer that, and they will not want to take that option. Due to one simple reason is that they cannot wear N95 mask under the tight-fitting mask. So very interestingly, I learned that. I know that is due to personal preference or individual hospital needs. But that is something that I learned during the pandemic. Here are some pictures I would like to share. these pictures are not taken in Singapore. I have actually my colleague, my Malaysian colleague, that is actually doing the training in hospital in Malaysia. So he's together with me today as well. during the high peak seasons, during the MCOs, he has been getting, we have to apply for approval to move to hospital to conduct training so that to provide the frontliners the training needed for them to start using the PAPR as soon as possible. And we are really trying to protect the frontliners who are actually healing the patients. With that, this is actually my last slide. I'm glad that today I'm able to share something that you guys, some of you guys already know, some of you guys are first time hearing it. It's always good to learn something new each day. To conclude my webinar today, this is my last slide. As I mentioned, a very big thank you to all the frontliners, especially for those who are attending my webinar today. You guys are really important. You guys are really tired. We really want to thank you, taking this opportunity to thank you guys for putting yourself in such a risk, but yet still trying to protect each one of us. So thank you very much.